This portion of the talk is on tinnitus. Now, tinnitus is going to be another topic for which you are probably going to have much more of a relationship with your patient than with, say, other aspects of what we've talked about, because you're going to meet the patient who's going to have the head noise, and you're going to be the first one who's going to get the complaint. And so there are going to be a lot of things that you're going to do right off the bat for the patient. So, tinnitus. Lights down a little bit, Cliff. Tinnitus, it's most important that you read this and read it quite closely. Tinnitus is a symptom. Tinnitus is not a disease. Therefore, you can't treat tinnitus without looking for a disease. Because if you treat the tinnitus, then the patient may have a serious disease for which you have not provided the proper treatment, and therefore the disease will get worse and worse and worse. So you can't consider your treatment, quotes, of tinnitus a failure to treat the tinnitus unless you've really looked for a disease or a possibility as to why the patient has that tinnitus. So again, tinnitus, a symptom, not a disease. So when you look at tinnitus, when you go through a process like you do with all the other patients you have and all the other disease processes, where you do evaluation, examination, and then most importantly, explanation, you have to think about what is tinnitus. Tinnitus, then, is really two forms, an objective and subjective. Objective meaning that the patient hears it, the patient has it, and you, the physician, also hear it. Something is producing that head noise, which is there. You yourself can identify it. And let's discuss a little bit more about in what cases that you probably will be able to identify. And then subjective tinnitus. Subjective tinnitus, the patient hears it, but no one else can. So it's a sensation by the patient himself, but not verified by someone else. Now, objective tinnitus. What are forms of objective tinnitus? Vascular problems and muscular problems. You can examine the patient simply enough by using auscultation, stethoscopes, Toynbee tubes. Toynbee tube is basically like an apparatus which will fit into the ear. Rubber tubing that goes to another apparatus that will fit in your ear. So you have the patient put one side in his ear, the side with the tinnitus, you place the opposite side in your ear, and you ask the patient, are they hearing their tinnitus? The patient says yes or no, and then you say, well, yes or no, I hear it at the same time. Sometimes a vascular problem by the patient pressing on the neck will occlude the carotid or possibly the jugular vein and occlude the tinnitus. And then you can have, you hear also the occlusion of that tinnitus. Muscularly, there is movement of the two muscles that were discussed by John earlier, where you get set up vibrations of the tympanic membrane itself, possibly, or spasm of just the muscles, clicking sensation. Palatal myoclonus is a elevation of the palate itself, creates, because of the connection to the eustachian tube and opening and closing of the eustachian tube, and then also sensation of clicking sensation. Tinnitus, by definition, means sort of head noise. I mean, head noise then can be whistling, high tension wire, clicking sensation. Any extraneous noise is tinnitus, not just, quotes, ringing in the ears. Tinnitus may also be the result of temporomandibular joint dysfunction. again because of the muscle action around the ear. You've gone through an attempt to sort of define what might create tinnitus. One of the easiest ways to decide what it is exam. This, as we were speaking earlier, there are many different individuals who come in with head noise or other reasons, and it's due to something quite simple. There are many other individuals who come in with something else, and on exam, when you look in the ear, you'll see something else. From the normal ears that you're used to looking at, this, of course, doesn't really appear all that normal. You have this reddish mass that is sort of bulging out at the inferior aspect of the eardrum. You can't really tell whether it's posterior or anterior. It's sort of right in this, coming up in the center, but most likely this is a tumor of the jugular bulb, a glomus jugulari, or maybe a glomus tympanicum. The other thing you'd have to consider is possibly just a dehiscence of the bony covering over the jugular bulb, and the jugular bulb sits quite high in the middle ear. Perhaps the carotid artery is dehiscent and it sits quite high in the middle ear. So for some of you who are, say, surgically oriented, who do many sort of office procedures on your own, you have to be careful that occasionally what might be considered a serosotitis may be one of these vascular problems, and so doing a, say, meningotomy or a tympanosynthesis to find what this organism is, you may end up with blood rather than culture. So you have to be sure that you examine the ear quite closely before you do some of those surgical techniques. Subjective tinnitus. That doesn't mean the patient's making it up. No, it doesn't mean the patient is psychotic. It does mean, though, that the patient may have some psychological personality traits that might lead him to be more susceptible to head noise, to tinnitus. People who are easily depressed, when an individual is tired, when an individual is under a lot of stress, those individuals are more likely not to have tinnitus, but possibly to be unable to cope with the tinnitus. Therefore, the tinnitus for them produces more problems. It's more annoying. When you have subjective tinnitus, it can occur with or without a hearing loss. And the hearing loss can be sensory, neural, or conductive. Treating the tinnitus. Once you've gone through an attempt to decide, is there a problem? In deciding, is there a problem? Asking the patient whether the tinnitus is pulsatile or constant is somewhat of a help. Pulsatile tinnitus is usually sort of put in an area where they feel, well, that's more like a vascular tumor, a problem with the carotid artery, a problem with the jugular bulb. Not always. Is the tinnitus constant, high-pitched? Is the tinnitus the more of a low roaring sound? These are descriptions that might fit with more of a disease process. A fluctuating, low roaring tinnitus that goes along with a fluctuating hearing loss, that goes along with episodes of dizziness, along with pressure in one ear, that sounds more like Meniere's disease. So there are going to be different aspects depending upon history as to what you might categorize, again, the disease that may cause the symptom of tinnitus. When you finally have gone through your evaluation and you come to the patient and the patient finally says, well, gee, doc, I mean, isn't there anything you can do? There are things that we can do. However, it's important to understand, again, that since tinnitus is the symptom, specific treatment for the symptom, because you don't treat the symptom. You try to treat the underlying cause. So as Britt was talking, as mentioning, maskers and hearing aids. Probably the most common cause of head noise is a hearing loss. The fact that you can't hear, as Britt said, the sounds around you, you end up sort of hearing, you might call, your own body noise, the turbulence of that blood flow. Since, as in the diagrams, the anatomy, you saw that the carotid artery, the jugular bulb are right next to the ear, there is going to be turbulence. There are going to be extraneous sources of information, of sound, electricity, that the, quote, ear will pick up. So you have to look at treatment of hearing loss. Biofeedback for those individuals that have those certain personality traits, that it's difficult for them to deal with stress. It's difficult for them to deal with other aspects of life. Biofeedback sometimes works very well for those individuals in helping them take care of their tinnitus. Take care of it again by decreasing the symptom, allowing them to be able to cope with it better. Medical and surgical treatments. Well, let's do surgical first. If you have a conductive hearing loss, say like otosclerosis, that can lead to lack of hearing of the outside sounds. Doing surgery, doing the stapedectomy improves their hearing. Tinnitus is better. Chronic ear problems. Again, taking care of the hearing, improving the hearing, tinnitus is better. There really isn't, though, in some patients, as might be, has been mentioned in the literature, and may be mentioned to you, it certainly sounds logical, patient walks in and says, gee, doc, I got such bad tinnitus and it's on this one side only, you know, I don't care. If nothing's done, I'm going to do something about it myself. I'll take my life, do anything I want, but you just got to get rid of the ear. Take the ear. So somebody will say, well, that sounds logical. We'll cut the auditory nerve and we'll get rid of the tinnitus. That, unfortunately, is not successful. Sort of like phantom pain. Removal, amputation of the lower leg doesn't get rid of the itching of the big toe. So eighth nerve section for tinnitus is not something that we recommend. Medical. Assuming that you've gone through your whole process of evaluation, and let me make one mention of evaluation at this time. Before, or some individuals felt that since tinnitus could be caused by a possible serious vascular problem, angiography was, you know, one of the sort of main tests. We rarely do angiography. The main test of evaluation of a patient with tinnitus is, first of all, a hearing test. Do they have a hearing loss? Then, based upon the type of hearing test you get and your physical exam, then you decide if you need to go further with other tests of evaluations. The whole process of your workup is, again, to rule out any serious disease. So you need to go to the extent that you should go to rule out any serious disease. So you don't jump from nothing to an angiogram to rule out a vascular problem when something else can be involved. So you may go through a process of hearing test, special hearing tests that we talked about, impedance, audiometric brainstem response, x-ray examinations, polytomography, CAT scans. You may end up with a angiogram. But again, you're doing the tests as you do many of your tests now in a logical, stepwise manner, doing what you need to do that's appropriate. Medically, you've ruled out everything. Now you're down to try to use some medicines to treat this symptom, this tinnitus. Well, again, since there's no disease to treat, the medicines you use are not going to be specific. They're going to be non-specific symptom-relieving treatments. So medicines that have been used and tried and sometimes work very well, niacin, thiamine, vitamins. For those patients that just want something, you give them something and they get better. Did the niacin or thiamine work? Who knows? For other patients, maybe dilantin, tegretol, that has been suggested. One individual, a physician, in another country, he uses lidocaine intravenously, sees if the patient gets a response. If the patient gets a response to the intravenous lidocaine, which does not last long, that patient, he feels, is going to be the type of patient who has maybe a nervous irritation that is going to be responsible to dilantin or tegretol. Rather than giving the intravenous lidocaine, one can start with the dilantin or tegretol. The problem is, of course, as you'd use more and more of these medications, there's more and more side effects of the medication. Because many patients who have the tinnitus, and it's primarily a coping problem, and maybe there's some personality aspects, maybe some depression, antidepressants are used quite often. One tablet, say, per night, or maybe a tablet at night before you go to bed in the morning. Mainly at night because, again, of the quiet aspects. Most people's complaint of tinnitus is when it's quiet. So the use of an antidepressant is sometimes very helpful. An antidepressant rather than a tranquilizer. Because, again, patients who have the tinnitus, they're not necessarily hyped up. I mean, that's their personality is more of depression. So you'd rather not tranquilize them even further. That might make it louder. So antidepressants are used more often. And then finally, probably most important, we get back to evaluation, examination, but explanation. You've gone through the process. You've gone through your workup. You're sure there's no serious disease. You've got them on the hearing aid. You've given the biofeedback. The most important aspect of your treatment in this case with tinnitus is explanation. It's education. Letting the patient know what they have, what is not present, what they don't need to worry about, and explain to them certain situations where they should expect to have some head noise. So, quietness, tired, under stress, they should expect some increased head noise. Usually that explanation alone is enough to help them out. So in a way, you come back to the old lady, and you come back to the statement, well, it is something that you learn to live with, but you've learned to basically be better and cope with. That's tinnitus in a nutshell. We're way ahead of time.